Okay, good evening and good morning. Welcome to EarthCore's Global Learning Summit. On this panel, I'm really excited to talk to each of you about the Global Trail community. We're going to start off by introducing ourselves and our roles at our various organizations where we're coming from. And then we're going to dive into some conversational questions. I'm really excited to talk with you all today about the Global Trail community. My name is Whitney. I'm the field director here at EarthCore. I'm calling in from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. So it's about 8 o'clock where I am right now. I have been at EarthCore in and out for the last 10 years. I was a program participant in 2013, and I joined in staff in 2019. As the field director here at EarthCore, I work really closely with our projects team to fill our crew calendar with meaningful projects for their program year. I have a strong background in trail construction and design. As I look forward at our project pipeline, I am seeing a lot more trail work, which is probably because we have myself and other colleagues that are very interested and enthusiastic about trail construction and maintenance around the Puget Sound area. So again, I'm very excited to be joined by this lovely panel of people, and I'm going to ask Ariadna if you would like to introduce yourself and where you're coming from.
Thank you, Whitney. My name is Ariadna Rida, and I'm calling from Seattle, Washington. It's about 6 p.m. right now over here. And I work for the organization, nonprofit organization that is based in California but works all over the world called Earth Island Institute. And for the last about 20 years, I've been involved in different projects to develop projects and run projects on environmental education and ecotourism. My background goes back 20 years ago when we started a project that became an organization called the Great Baikal Trail back in Siberia. This was a lovely startup that developed into organization and brought a lot of people from all over the world. I was the first director for this organization, and that project and organization would not have been possible without involvement of EarthCore, that's been our partner for a very long time. And we had a lot of volunteers and staff members that went through EarthCore trainings. That's it, I guess.
Thank you. Ashot, would you like to introduce yourself?
Thank you so much. So I'm Ashot from Armenia. I have started my career back in 2017 from the first long distance hiking trail project in the Caucasus called the Transcaucasian Trail. And now I am introducing Trails for Change NGO, a nonprofit organization working in Armenia on trail construction, maintenance, and community development programs, and outdoor education for young people. I'm really excited to be in this panel and to share knowledge and experience with all. We are having a lot of trail projects every year, and now mostly are going focusing on trail education for young people to share everything, mostly for the rural communities. And we're also extending the trail network in Armenia and connection to the Caucasus countries. It was really interesting for me to go to this field in 2017 when we started the first international trail summer camp to have a lot of people from different countries. And as you remember, there were people which participated also in the EarthCore and shared their experience bringing to Armenia, Georgia, and on that first trail project of the Transcaucasian Trail. After that, we formed with the former volunteers, we formed the Trails for Change NGO, which became a leading organization in Armenia on the trail construction and maintenance, and we continue to develop.
And my name is Robert Birkby. I live in Seattle. And my start with trails really began escaping a small farm in Iowa where there were no trails and no vertical relief. And in my college summers, I discovered the Boy Scouts had a national high adventure base in New Mexico called Philmont that had both mountains and trails. And that the best job was working on trail crews because you could spend the whole summer in the backcountry. And that's where I learned my basic skills. I went on for, had a career for a while as an academic teaching writing at a college in Missouri, and then hiked the Appalachian Trail and headed west because the Pacific Crest Trail is out here, and discovered Seattle and all sorts of trail opportunities. And through the years, I've had sort of a split career between being a writer and a trails guy. I've worked a lot with Student Conservation Association, with Earth Corps, Trans-Caucasus Trail, most recently a trail in Greenland, the Arctic Circle Trail. The opportunities just seem to have kept coming my way. If I were willing to pack up my bags and go sometimes where Ariadna suggested and sometimes places I found on my own. And so very delighted to be in this discussion about the worldwide nature of trails, that it's really becoming an international phenomenon, well worth pursuing and encouraging.
That's lovely. Thank you all for those great introductions. As I said, I'm very excited. My first exposure to trail work was actually at Earth Corps and through the collaboration with organizations like the Great Baikal Trail and some of my crewmates being from the Great Baikal. And and it was a really lovely experience learning about trails from them while also learning how to build and construct trails around the Puget Sound area. So so to get started, each of you mentioned your background in building and maintaining and planning trails, and you're all situated around different parts of the world. And I'm excited, as I said, to dive into what we share and how we differ in approaches to make trails accessible and sustainable. Open for the whole panel, what are some key policies and regulations related to hiking and trail building in your area? And how do you navigate these regulations? And like for working in the United States, for example, a trail can navigate through multiple land agencies, which all have their own regulations that you have to consider when designing or constructing a trail. And so I'd hear from each of you around your experience managing and moving through regulations to create sustainable and accessible trails. And Ariadna, how about we go ahead and start with you?
So a lot of our work was involved to strengthen the protected areas in the region. And I think I will refer to the Great Baikal Trail experience mainly answered this question for now, because all people, all places are different. And for us, when we try to encourage, strengthen, build capacity for national parks, it was about building trails. And actually, the initiative came from them that they would like to have trails mainly to manage tourists, to direct them to certain places and direct them away from other places that they would like to be more protected. So that, and when we got to work with them, that was following their regulations. And that was the best thing, I think, that we've done, created a really good relationship with the protected lands in the area. And it was very different, like national parks and nature preserves, which is another category of lands that is protected lands. They were very willing to create MOUs and contracts with GBT as a nonprofit organization and move forward. On the other hand, it was quite difficult to get together and sign anything with the Forest Service in Siberia. So that was challenging, and we were not able to build any trails on their lands. We were able to improve the fire trails for them that were used as trails by people, but they would not make any contracts with us to improve on them or build new ones. It was quite difficult to build trails near the cities. It became easier with time when the name was established, and the city governments started to believe that we are capable of helping out. So it was very different on different levels. Mm-hmm. And on one kind of bigger picture, I think that was on a regional level. On the bigger level, when we started to build trails, there was no other organization within the region, within the country, that was building trails. We were the first. And there were no laws about trails, no laws about how they should be built, no specifications. So all this experience was brought from abroad and adapted to the region and became a model that eventually made it a regional law. And I can talk for a long time, but that's kind of, you know, in a nutshell for now.
Yeah, that's great. Robert or Ashat, do you have any thoughts around navigating regulations in your trail work background or in regions that you've worked?
Yeah, I mean, it's... go ahead. Yeah,
I was going to follow up with Ariadna, since I've been with her on a number of occasions in Siberia, working with various authorities, local and national people who had some control over what happened there. Both there and other places internationally where I've gone, one of the first big challenges is to figure out what the regulations might be. And on occasion, discovering there aren't any. Or if they have them, where did they come from? Who is behind these and what's really at stake here? And just sorting that out, I've had occasion where I spent a month somewhere, and it was just the sorting out process of figuring out who can actually approve things. What's the heritage here? What have they done in the past going forward? We had the experience, Ariadne and I, this summer in Mongolia, going to a park that pretty seriously wanted a trail to build. And as we were looking for a trail to build, we suddenly, after a week, realized almost this entire park is on permafrost. And inappropriate for building a trail as we think of constructing a trail. And so we did a lot of what our effort there was figuring out, why do you want this trail in the first place? Secondly, are there alternatives that are already here? And third, if we're going to put in a trail, how technically can you build in a marshy, mushy surface? That came into play again later in the summer when I was in Greenland. The Arctic Circle Trail is 100 miles from the ice field to the sea. And they began using all-terrain vehicles on portions of this historic trail. The entire trail is on permafrost. Mm. And the areas that are being used now by all-terrain vehicles are just being torn to shreds, because that's what motorized vehicles do on permafrost. And our job was to relocate 20 miles of the trail, to just give over the part that the all-terrain vehicles are already using and give hikers an area that's not open to all-terrain vehicles. But there too, a lot of the discussion was, why are you allowing all-terrain vehicles here at all? And a lot of people had really compelling reasons that they brought to the table about that. We had long discussions about, if you're going to do that, how can you do it in a technical way that doesn't damage the environment? Or if it does, do you just create a sacrifice zone? Historically, with Inuit people using these trails in the winters with dog sleds and so on. There were so many really interesting and compelling arguments coming from different directions, that simply piecing together what's really at work there on the land and how can then you address that mm-hmm. becomes a big part of the challenge and also the satisfaction of figuring it out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's part of the challenge in trail construction and trail design is the point is to invite people in and have an experience, and at the same time, it's as the more people you invite in, the more potential there is for resource damage in those natural areas. And I have a lot of follow-up questions I'd love to ask the two of you. I'd also love to hear from Ashat around some of the regulations that you have to navigate. What are some of those challenges that you've experienced, Ashat?
Yeah, it's kind of the similar situation which Ariadna was talking about. Like when we started back in 2017, the first professional trail design and trail work in our country. Of course, there were other trails before that, and there were mostly jeep roads, dirty jeep roads, and just old historic trails used by hikers or visitors. We started the first work with National Park, one of the national parks in Armenia, which was a great experience because, of course, before that, a lot of trails were included in the management plans as an ecotourism ways or ecotourism paths for national parks. And it seems that the model worked as like having the MOUs, regulation, I mean, not regulations for digging the dirt, but just going to work on the trails was not a surprise for the national park. But after that, when we started to spread to other parts of the country, like in some parts, like working with the forest committee or with the community lands was kind of a new thing. And people didn't imagine why these trails are being built, what they have to sign, why they have to bring there to a paper or where they have to put, because there's no regulation in the country at this moment to recognize a trail as an infrastructure, unfortunately, except the national parks or protected areas. But then after that, the State Tourism Committee, which is mostly the head of, I mean, of managing tourism in the country, started to again recognize that trails are really important things for the tourism industry. We brought the guidelines for trail marking and standards, one standard guidebook, which is also mostly the same with Georgia. So we just brought from abroad the experience from abroad, translated and experienced and tested. Now it's good that now we are working on the trail construction manuals or guidelines to be the same for all country. And the national parks protected areas are starting to more focus, be interested to bring the trails in the management plans to recognize, to have buffer zones for trails to to keep them managed and bring them on the table. But of course, there are a lot of challenges yet because there are communities or protected areas which again do not want to, you know, dig into that because then they have to manage these trails, but they don't know how. Of course, we support as much as we can. And of course, some protected areas and land management agencies or community management organizations do recognize the importance and are really happy to have trail builders or trails in their plans or development strategies.
Yeah, this is a great segue into another question I had, and also touches base on some of the previous conversation around like how do we continue to educate hikers and outdoor enthusiasts about responsible trail use? So this would be in like leave no trace principles, safety on trails, and limiting, again, that resource damage, expanding beyond just the tread itself off into the surrounding natural areas. So Robert, you had started to mention some of your work in some really sensitive habitats. So how do you continue to educate outdoor enthusiasts and hikers to use trails responsibly?
Well, I think ideally, if you can encourage young people to begin in the right ways, I've worked a lot with the Boy Scouts of America, written some of their manuals, outdoor guides, and a lot of what we emphasize there is starting small and starting responsibly. And that's one way to do it. Another challenge is people who come to the trails without any foreknowledge, without any background in how you treat the outdoors. You can do a lot with signage, with interpretive efforts. You can do a lot by people who are also on the trails providing a good example. But that's a big challenge of how do you encourage people not to do something so simple as cutting switchbacks. Nobody cuts switchbacks going uphill, but there's a real temptation to cut them coming downhill. And how sort of the ethic of that a trail carries with people who are there with their informational signs and so on. But it's difficult to know. Hopefully people who are on the trail and see things that are being done can gently encourage better behavior and see if that works as well.
Ariadna, you look like you have a thought.
It starts, I think, always with planning. If it's possible to do, sometimes we start doing something without having a bigger plan or having resources for that, or we think we don't have resources. So it's kind of building trails. We always said it's an excuse to do many, many, many different things. And one of the most important one is education. So there were multiple approaches how to encourage any visitors, any hikers to take care of the land. And for our experience, we had international camps, 2 week long. Half of the participants would be local and half would be internationals. And they were stuck together for 2 weeks building trails, but also would have some fun on a weekend doing some local activities. And all the camp was planned using the LNT, Leave No Trace principles, although those days nobody called it this way. We just tried to minimize any impact on nature the way we thought should be. So a lot of these people, that they were the first people who were educated how to behave in nature, and they took these principles back to their homes, trying to find recycling programs in their places because they've been doing it, trying to do composting because they've been doing it for 2 weeks. Since there were a lot of local people involved, that helped to raise their pride in having this treasure of Lake Baikal in their backyard. And when other people showed that they respected and enjoyed that, that kind of helped them to start taking care of it too. A lot of places we try to, talking about planning, to build in a program, again, started to plan it with local people. With national parks, but as well as villages who lived on national parks lands or nearby, that they could help out first to build trails. So we would involve them into building trails themselves in these international camps. That was an exciting opportunity for them because a lot of them never left the places they were born. So for them, bringing the world to them was wow. And after that, they would be kind of guardians of the trails. They would hike them and then they would report what needs to be done. And that kind of this collaboration and a little bit of planning in advance, because maintenance of the trail, as we all know, is a big part. Build is like, 2 weeks you have a stretch of trails, but who will maintain it? Right. So that was an important part. And then, like Bob mentioned, that's very important to think about how people, like structurally, Will people go certain places or not go in certain places, and put in signage, and again involving local people and helping this out. And then I guess it's education, one person at a time, one group at a time, whatever is possible. And then social media came up, and improving of the website of the Great Baikal Trail, that all helped. And recently, the group of people who've started to work on developing Leave No Trace principles for the country, they recently finished their website that is now kind of pushing these principles to be used by many and all if possible. So multi-stage, multi-faceted approach.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. In my experience in trail design, it's been very rare that the design that I've been asked to consider or create isn't in response to a poorly placed trail to begin with. It's usually moving it, or when I'm doing a reroute or walking and assessing a trail for the first time, I'm often muttering about, well, we shouldn't have been down here in the first place. We should be up there. We should be skirting the hillside. We're in the wetland. Of course it's wet. And now we have to put a structure in or something like that. So that design element is key for those very first steps. And then I like what we've talked about with users on the trail, and what their experience is and how you guide folks and how you teach them. You had mentioned working with like volunteer support. And so I'm curious to hear more from you around your trails that depend on volunteer support and community engagement. And how does Trails for Change engage local communities in trail projects?
Yeah, first thing, of course, as Ariadna was mentioning, the engagement with community, the villagers, is the key. And we came to this when we had the first summer camp with international locals, bringing locals, the knowledge to the locals, which was a very new thing. Why we are building the trails, what these trails will bring. So this was the idea which the organization is also called Trails for Change, to bring the change to the communities by trails. And when we were constructing the first trails in Dilijan National Park, in one of the national parks in Armenia, and bringing people to build the trails from the villages, other parts of the country. So after the project, the season was finished, people thought, oh, okay, they're gone and they're not going to come back. This was one of the short programs everyone is doing. But then next year, when they were seeing that, oh, these people are coming back, they again want us to be involved, to maintain the trails, to do something. And wow, they also offer us jobs. We can be paid for just going to our neighborhood, to the forest, to do some work. Of course, this is the most important, if you can provide some job opportunities for the community, but it's not always. And the volunteering is not as much spread as, for example, the United States, but it's going to become, because every year, a lot of volunteers, a lot of young people are getting involved in volunteering programs, and especially in the trail programs. But anyway, we are diversifying all these opportunities, and mostly for the communities out of the towns. And as Ariana again was mentioning, that these people who are staying in the villages are becoming the ambassadors, the people who are going to take care of the trails later and going to be to get benefits. So we were trying and are trying to show this is beneficial for the trail communities. If you're into tourism, if you're not going to do any other job but earn your money for your family by tourists, because you can provide services for the hikers who are coming by the trails. And this was the case when the first guest houses appeared in one of the villages, when there were no guest house, and because of the trails, the hikers flow came to this village and people started to get job or to earn money because they saw the change. So this is very important to keep a fact, and the educational part that we now are more focused to bring the knowledge to the young people and to the community members, that they also get this leave no trace principles, how to build trails, how to maintain them, how to get benefits from the trails. It's all a part of the community engagement, all a part of these educational programs, which are really doing bringing the change to the communities. And the interesting fact is that other communities see the model, see this working in their neighborhoods, their neighbor communities, and they are getting interested more. And they are waiting when these people will come to us, when the hikers will come to us. So it's kind of making also competitive like platform of people starting to think more about tourism, trails, how to do their best to have trails in their neighborhood too.
Yeah, it sounds like a positive feedback loop, right? And yeah. Creating a community that cares for their trail system and then also gets a direct return from that care. That's really lovely. Thank you for sharing that. So my next question is for Robert. As an author of multiple editions of the Boy Scout Handbook, and I just have to say I have a special place for the Boy Scouts. As I was starting my career in environmental work, I taught many a Boy Scout badge classes early on. I might have even read some of your handbooks as I was trying to learn more about the Boy Scouts. I'm curious, how do you go about synthesizing the most essential and applicable information? Specifically, I'm interested around like safety in trails or safety, like building or using trails. How do you create that in like a synthesized form, educational format?
So how do you protect Boy Scouts when they're on the trails, and how do you protect the trails from the Boy Scouts? You know, the early Scouts, the camping that they did and the hiking they did, generally they always carried an axe. That was just part of the equipment. And they would build, they do all their cooking over open fires. And you know, today we just don't have that need anymore. But, you know, to a 12-year-old kid, to have an axe and get to use it is a really pretty big deal. And for a lot of kids to be able to go off in the woods with scouts and, you know, use pocket knives and chop things and saw things, that's part of the deal. And if you can direct that toward trail projects, it's a great way to mix that energy and that eagerness to use tools. And you can introduce a whole lot of other tools that come into it along the way at age appropriate levels. So I think that's part of it. And going on the experience of leaders and what they know, and you know, people learn by doing, and they learn by being mentored. And that's where we come in as people that have some clarity about how best to run trail crews and so on, to share that knowledge and help those who are coming up to do the right thing as they go.
Can I add to that?
Yes, please.
Like, when we were just starting, I remember the first thing that I've translated, and I learned some years later that it was Bob's writing, the small booklet on how to build trails. And the biggest part that was of interest to us, it was safety. So that was essential. And then came the structures and all the other stuff, because we were planning to run international camp and safety and different standards of safety, because like for local people, it's one level of safety. For internationals, it's different. And making sure that, first of all, everybody is safe was essential. So that was one of the first things that we've translated and used in Russian, that was produced by Bob. And then we translated the whole book, Lightly on the Land, that was essential for not just the Great Baikal Trail, but many trails. They started to pop up all over the country. And that, I think that by itself became the essential piece that we have some good information that everybody could use. But then a lot of people would not just limit themselves with the book, because they needed, as Bob said, somebody who showed them how to do that. And we would invite, we actually, for safety on the Great Baikal Trail, we found a local doctor who went to the United States, and he took a course on safety, mm-hmm. and he brought it back. And he, every spring, he would teach it to the crew leaders who would go and become crew leaders at Lake Baikal. So mm-hmm. that was essential, this combination that everybody knows basic safety, plus you have trainings for the crew leaders.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot of deep knowledge that can come along with like wilderness first aid safety, and yes. that goes beyond just safety training to keep our bodies safe, but just in decision making. And that's really lovely. Speaking of safety, you know, trail building is physically demanding work, and all of us here have built trails ourselves and probably felt the impact on our bodies. I'm curious, how do your organizations in your various regions support trail builders in maintaining their bodies in trail work, and or volunteers as well? And how do we prevent burnout from happening? I myself have had when I worked for the alongside the Park Service, and the Forest Service too, there was these sort of legacy mentors that I had, older guys that have been doing the thing for 30, 40 years. And I just thought, how do you do this for 40 years? Like, you know, in my 20s, I was starting to get tired. So and maybe I was going too hard, but I'm curious, for each of your organizations, how do you help people keep on building trails and not burning out their bodies? Maybe Ariadne or Ashat, yeah, let's start with you.
Yeah, so the thing is that I remember the first experience in 2017 back again. So I lived in the forest for 3 months, having 2 days off in the town, nearby town, and I was so happy to have this summer 3 months for my body to have this experience on the trails, because then I have this muscles. And then of course year by year I bet more on the project management, getting less trail building, and now I really miss, but sometimes of course I do go and work, but I really saw this impact like in a positive way, but also like that this can be unregulated, or people should focus on, should control this, of course. So now we do this conservation corps programs in our countries. Like one is called Youth for Change Conservation Corps. And the first thing is, again, we'll start with the safety, with the tools, how to, you know, have all the safety procedures. And for the people who are newcomers, who don't know what can happen. So the first thing I think is the knowledge we bring on this summer camps, this educational camps. And of course, people who are getting interested to work more and more, we see this, you know, the motivation, the enthusiasm which they have to work on the trails, but sometimes we see that they get tired, and we bring this opportunity for them to have some changes, like to have some office work, or to work on the trail trail development with their brain, to start writing some stories, mm-hmm. or to go to some scoutings, not take tools, or so kind of bringing different activities, because I know that this can be also demotivational when people are always on the trails whole summer or whole season. But of course, there are people who like that, and you can't take them out of the trails. But surely, we are really focused on the safety and bring the knowledge to people So we don't want to lose anyone. We don't want to lose the people get out of the trail if they are really good in it and really like. So some things should, which we really put our eyes on.
I think some of it is, if possible, providing variety, that you're not doing the same kind of work all the time, and people are able to see progress as you're going along. I had a trail crew some years ago where all we did day after day was clear slough and berm off the trail. And it was really compacted, and it was really hard to get the trail as wide as it should be. And we just chugged along day after day after day, and they were getting really tired of that. And one day I ran ahead a few hundred yards, and I tied a piece of flagging ribbon across the trail from one tree to another. And I came back and I said, my gosh, I hiked up ahead. And I found something, and worked around the corner, and they saw it, and they said, is that the finish line? And I said, that's the halfway point. We're almost halfway. And they said, that's great. We had no idea. So you can tell people in that case. I think another aspect of it too is just the social nature of trail work. If you're just a few people on a professional trail crew, you're getting paid, and that's a big incentive. We work enormously with volunteers, and I've had the experience like that crew with the ribbon across the trail. Through social media, people that were on my cruise decades ago now, who are in their 40s today, but were with me when they were 16 or 17 years old, we've reconnected. And I talked to them about those programs. Some of those programs I remember as really rainy, muddy, miserable. People didn't get along. The food was, it was a tough program. They look back on it as one of the great events of their lives. To be in a new place, to be among new people, have real work given to them, as much responsibility and a little more as we could possibly give them. So I think we sometimes see things through our adult eyes, through our experienced eyes, and it is a little difficult to put ourselves in the place of people doing this for the first time or early in their trail experiences. And how really life-changing all of that can be, even if you're just widening a trail day after day and camping, going back to camp at night and cooking your meals and being with your group of friends that you'll be friends with forever.
And goes back to planning, because we planned the season, building season at Lake Baikal is quite short. It's pretty much 3 months only. So, all the work was with volunteers. So the main people who we worried about were crew leaders. For crew leaders, they all came from younger people. And some of them were as young as 18 year old, become crew leader, leading a crew of people. And they might have volunteers who are, 70, 80 year old. Internationals, that was huge responsibility, and that was definitely a leadership training that we didn't think about as a leadership training. We just needed crew leaders. But it ended up that so many people who went through being prepared to be a crew leader, lead the camps, they became leaders in different kind of settings, environmental settings, future in their careers. And for them, it was spacing them and seeing that they lead 2 weeks and then they have some rest before they lead another 2 weeks. And it was experimenting to start with, but then it became intentional planning, not to do back to back, give them some time to recover. And for our cruise, it was usually 14 participants. Then it would be a crew leader and a helper. And crew leader would be experienced. Helper would be like in training, but also it's always good to have a second person, right? So it's kind of double role. And we would always have a person who will be translator, because it's international group, as well as work as a moderator and educator. So they would have balanced program. During the day, they work. In the evening, they cook meals together. They learn about the environment. They share stories. And there is a moderator who makes this happen. Otherwise, everybody could go to their tents. Then it was rainy season. When the rains come, what do? Again, planning ahead, making sure there is a big tent, the activities to do. We did quite a bit of signage in these rainy days because we were prepared that that might be the case. And kind of balancing all these things up and planning ahead, that's kind of the approach, I guess. I think the managers in the office were way more burnt out than actually people in the field. I was that manager who was like sending all this crews, and everybody said, oh, you have such a lovely organization and you are outside all the time and having fun. I was like, well, I'm outside only when the problem arises, and then I need to rush in and fix the problem. Otherwise, I'm in the office all summer.
I totally understand you.
This conversation is bringing up some old memories of mine, and how special my backcountry time was with the crews that I led and was on. And I remember on one trip, we were building a turnpike and we were harvesting natural materials. It was granite. So it was a granite scree field, and you know, the job was to fill the turnpike, and then we were going to crush the rock inside the turnpike to make our fill. But it was a big, big structure. And, you know, I thought, I have no idea how we're going to like physically bring all this rock. We had nothing. We were in wilderness, so we couldn't use any mechanical anything, right? And I remember looking at the person I was working with, my crewmate, and just said, I think that what we're just going to do is just one rock at a time. Each of us, we're just going to go at the pace we go. We're going to go get the rock and we're going to walk it back and we're just going to set it down and we'll just keep doing that until it's full. And breaking it down like that was really, really helpful. But those memories of working with my crew is like some of my favorite memories in the field. Ariadna, you had also mentioned, you had mentioned like you're kind of out there and that's it. Like those are the people you're with. You got to work through your conflict. You got to work through who's going to make dinner and, you know, all that good stuff. So, we're really unlocking some deep memories here for sure. Robert, I'm also curious for you, for regions or organizations just beginning their trail building. Actually, this could be really for everybody because it sounds like everybody has pioneered a new organization. But for those who are just beginning their trail building journey, organizations, what advice or best practices would you offer to help them get started and develop sustainable, accessible trails? Mm-hmm.
As I've been listening to these various stories, one thing that strikes me is both Ariadna and Ashat are involved with programs that have a huge goal. When I first went to Lake Baikal, what I learned from Great Baikal Trail was that they were going to build a trail around Lake Baikal, which is 1,000 miles, the Trans-Caucasian Trail. It's probably 1,000 miles when it's completed. And it crosses borders of 3 countries. I mean, these are huge goals. And it's like carrying one rock at a time, Whitney. You know, you're going to get a couple weeks of work done and then a couple more weeks. And to get a trail all the way around Lake Baikal is going to take a century, if you know, to get the whole thing done. But having those goals and having a vision, I think, for organizations is really important. You know, why are we doing this? If the vision can be a big trail like we're talking about here, or with a community group, if you know, opportunities for local people to use a park in different ways than they've been able to in the past. But having goals and having a vision out there that can resonate with people who are volunteering to work on those trails can be a huge part of going forward. Mm-hmm. We've talked a lot about having mentors, having experienced people that can bring in information about safety risk management, some of the techniques of trail work. And that's all important. But I think that spirit that is behind an organization is critical, that it be very positive and forward looking.
I mean, I totally agree. And the vision and having all this in our minds, like when we started the program, again, a lot of people didn't believe and were thinking, oh, this is the short-term, one of the short-term programs which are completed and are disappeared. But when they see coming back, when they see people growing and a team growing and engaging, the community engagement, which is also the key role, which we at first were not focusing on this, but then understood that this should be the number one thing for us. And of course, the educational component inside the organization for keeping the team motivated, keeping the team trained, and also giving the opportunity to educate others, train others. So, I mean, it was really difficult for us first, as none of us were had any experience leading organization or leading teams, but it came by the experience, it came by the years. And now we see how, when we look back, we see what was the path, how we went forward with the passion, of course, with the enthusiasm, but also with getting educated and getting the knowledge from the others, from the international people, from the locals, who also are very important, like local guides. When you're going to work somewhere with an organization which is based in, I don't know, in the capital or far from this community, who is your contact, who you trust, and the people who are living there in the communities, who are who know everything, mostly everything about their neighborhood, should be your key partners, your friends, so then they can help your organization and help their community to get more development on the trail or on the trail industry or the tourism.
Yeah, I would like to kind of build on what Bob said. Vision is a lot, because people in the countries like we work, people do not have money. Like here in the States, everybody complains, oh, we don't have money for this and that and everything. But when I look at opportunities that are available here, you can make your mind and you can find money. It's not like the money is not there. You just need to work yourself to find it and find resources and make connections and do. In the countries we work, money are not available for this kind of stuff. You really have to go far beyond to try to get things. So in this case, humans become the main asset. That's what you build on. It's built on people who are enthusiasts, who will do it no matter what, who will do several jobs and spend their time. They even sometimes don't know the word volunteer, but they are passionate about that. That's why they will do that. So, and only vision can unite people like that. When you started the Great Baikal Trail, the main kind of vision that we shared with a lot of partners, that we do not want extraction industry around Lake Baikal. There are all kind of natural resources in the ground over there. And however bad the tourism might be, it never will be as bad as bulldozers getting, you know, all the nature bulldozed over there. Mm-hmm. So, and bulldozing starts with roads. So people want access to places. They want to go, and they will go sometimes no matter what. If you provide the trail, they will go by trail. If you provide the road, they will go by road, but it will be a different level of people getting there and doing what they want. So over 20 years, I think the biggest success that fulfilled the vision, that there were a lot of trails built and providing access instead of roads, instead of industry. So that kind of about the vision. And talking about nature, I think one of the important tips for anybody who starting building trails, and the hardest skill, I would say, is a correct sighting of the trail. People, it's easier to learn skills, how to put constructions and, you know, crush rocks and everything, but how to sight a trail, having nature in mind first and visitor in mind second, that I think, and using the people. I don't know, Bob, how many times you came to Baikal to sight. It was year after year, Bob will come in the spring and together with several crew leaders go and plan for where the trail would go. Mm-hmm. And only because of that, going with a mentor and helping and trying to think how he thinks, people develop the skills, and now we have several good sighters over there. Yeah. So, but sighting is a biggie.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. When I'm teaching trail design to our program members, something I like to spend a little bit of time is on placement and a little bit around the psychology of trail users as well. So people are there to see the natural beauty that is there. If it's a waterfall, people will go see the waterfall. And so your placement of where your tread is important to consider when thinking about protecting the natural resources that are making that place special, right? And then as we are constructing the trail itself, the tread, thinking about where, you know, like we always say this, and one of my mentors taught this to me, that no matter how tough your boots are, nobody wants to step in water. You know, you could have muddy boots, and I do it myself. I catch myself all the time kind of stepping off to the side. And so when we're actually constructing and placing that tread, the importance of thinking about the psychology of, well, where is somebody going to put their foot around these rocks? Are they going to start stepping to the side? And then we get a wide, wide, wide tread over many years. But Ariadna, you sparked another question for me when you were talking about vision and accessibility. And I'm curious for everybody around how do we design trails that are accessible and accessible for all users with different accessibility needs. I'm familiar with some of the ADA compliance here in the United States, but I'm curious for the Great Baikal Trail, or for Ashot, for your organization, how do you two navigate accessibility in your regions?
No, you can go.
No, okay, you started. You go.
All right, thank you. So yeah, the great thing was that again, when we started the first professional trail work in Armenia, we had an expert from California, and who is also the founder of Trails for Change NGO, Hans Kafer. So we got a lot of knowledge. Of course, he was the first designer. He did the first designs of the trails, of the first sections of the Transcaucasian Trail, and then later on other projects, and he continues to come to Armenia every year and do more trail design. This was the best knowledge we could ever to have the right trail designs, because we saw how a bad trail can be and how a really good trail should be designed. And for accessibility, of course, the first thing to how it should be accessible for different kind of people with different physical abilities, with difficult ages and others. And then when we see the people hiking them, a lot of people even don't understand or don't go deeper how the trail was really designed. So now they can go back with the switchbacks up, or don't feel the something that they will feel if they were hike on a deep jeep road or a dirt road or the forest. So, I mean, this was really good that we had the trail designer, and now of course we keep it going. We have now the first ever wheelchair accessible trail in Armenia, one of the national parks, which we finished this year. And again, it was a hard and great project. It was hard because it was really responsibility on us to build the right trail for these people, because you know we want to give the opportunities for everyone to come and enjoy the nature. But it was really good experience also for our crew to do this. And when you see the results, when you see the people using this, this is another feeling. So, I mean, a lot of things, of course, go again to the planning, to the design, and of course, the goal. So you have to do this for everyone, to the people to come to the nature, starting from kids until aged people, and you have to do it professionally to get the best results.
Ariadna, I think about the trails on the east side of Lake Baikal, that when Great Baikal Trail Association started, you were just trying to figure out how to put down any kind of trail. And with success in that, people began to see, you know, that this is great for people to go hike. I'd like my friends to come, you know, a friend who's in a wheelchair, or, you know, my grandparents, this would be nice, but these trails are too difficult. And sort of an outgrowth of that, near Tan Hoi, there's a long boardwalk that goes out through a gorgeous marshy area up toward the mountains that I think is still being added on to. You know, a really long and elegant boardwalk that evolved out of learning the basics and moving forward. One of the people involved early in Great Baikal Trail, Andrei Sutnev in Ulaanade, very involved with urban accessible trails. You know, how do you get people in cities to visit their city parks? And you know, he's finding ways to make it accessible for anybody to go on them. And so I think that's kind of an outgrowth that, you know, we were talking about, how do you organize new organizations? It may be a little while before those projects evolve, but they're there, you know, and they're going to, as people gain skills and gain realization of what might be possible, those can happen as well.
So going back, that trail is an excuse, because we brought the concept of trail as something new, but also together with that was brought the concept of volunteerism, because nobody knew what volunteer is. And the old style Soviet volunteer meant that you have to come on Saturday and work all day for free. So when I would use the word volunteer in Russian, they would look at me like, are you crazy? I'm going to do it. No way. So we started to use an English word, volunteer, kind of adapted to Russian language, and started to fill it up with meaning. What does it mean? What benefits people have when they volunteer? Same thing with accessibility. Together with trails came a new concept, very new concept of accessibility. And as Bob mentioned, that came in the city settings first. The first, you know, even the pavement and the, how do you call it? The for the wheelchair to go from one elevation to another, the ramps, right? That was the beginning because of the trail. And then it was building short trails, for example, near a museum, that would allow people in wheelchairs to explore the area. Then we also built a trail in Botanical Garden that helped people to navigate over there. And we then doing the city trails, that was the same thing. So one trail, three new concepts for the country.
Wow, that's amazing. This is also reminding me of in trail design, how important it is to design your trail to the like appropriate user. I always like to use these examples from the International Mountain Bike Association. They have some really good graphics on how to build a bad mountain bike trail that, you know, is too abrupt or too steep, and realizing that, again, like, if if it's not an appropriate trail, people will still find a way. And it might not be the most appropriate way, or it might not be the safest way to utilize that trail. So again, all coming back to that planning and design of your trail to start is the very first step. I have just a couple more questions. One that came up for me earlier was, all of you have spoken around working with local communities and volunteers. And I am wondering how do you, or if you incorporate local knowledge or indigenous knowledge into trail design or techniques, how is that knowledge passed into some of your work that you've accomplished? And this is, yeah, we'll start maybe with a shot. I've heard you talk a lot about your local communities.
Yeah. So this is really a nice, my favorite topics, because at first we were building the trails. I mean, we did a lot of new tread cuttings. Mm-hmm. When we discovered that in our country, we have a lot of ancient trails, which have been used for ages, decades, centuries ago for connecting villages to monasteries, connecting village to village, or a village to the fields. Mm-hmm. And these trails, I mean, these were not trails, these were roads for horses or for donkeys, because there were no cars, but these were mm-hmm. so well designed and constructed that now we use them as trails, putting them on the maps. I know there are a lot of countries in the world do the same. For example, mm-hmm. I hiked in Greece, I saw the same. Mm-hmm. But this is so promising that you're not only just clearing this road, old mm-hmm. roads, and putting them on the trail map. And this is we do with help of the local people, because they all know where they are. And what, now we have the trail eyes, and we can see from a distance this was an ancient trail, ancient road, so we can now bring it to the maps. And when you hike it, and when you put it on information about that, this is another value. When hiker hikes on a trail which had been used centuries ago, and you just feel, go back to the history. But of course, this is because we use the knowledge of the community, of the people mm-hmm. who live there. Mm-hmm. And of course, a lot of maps, different maps, Soviet maps, which show the old trails to there. And the mountain guides who are always in the mountains can find something and then report to you, oh, I found some piece of trail. It could be some piece of mm-hmm. or a part of a wide network. So this is something which I sometimes call we found a gold mm-hmm. in the trail industry, because I really like this, when just finding these old paths, putting on the maps, clearing them. It's really easy to maintain, not to dig another tread, mm-hmm. and also for the environment, we're not just touching the ground. We are just mm-hmm. clearing and putting on the maps.
Yeah, it's also just reducing continued impact in the area too. If you already have something that exists, utilizing that first before, you know, creating another way. It's smart design and smart process too. Yeah.
So for us, it was not so much techniques that we used, but the knowledge where to site a trail, where the resources are that locals do not want us to go, and otherwise, like some fun places that we can show tourists. So that was kind of one of the things. Another thing is their stories, especially older people, native people around Lake Baikal. There is a big nationality that is close to Mongolians, and they occupy half of the area around Lake Baikal. And their main religions are shamanism and Buddhism. So there are a lot of stories there that could be incorporated in education, or finding other approaches to teaching Leave No Trace, for example, from the standpoint what is sacred, and that will definitely cater more to the audience that comes from around the lake. Mm-hmm. So yeah.
Part of my experience with all this in the mid-1980s, Working with SCA, we started a wilderness work skills program, teaching week-long trail building courses and inviting people from organizations, from the Forest Service, Park Service. And we started in Yellowstone. We did four programs in a row for 2 summers. And then we felt we were smart enough and skilled enough, we'd take our show on the road. And so we outfitted some trucks and started these long road trips all over America to different parks and forests, and to bring the word of trails as we had discovered them. And we learned very quickly that we didn't know all that much, that every part of the country had their own skills. And they were very, very proud of them. And in many cases, they had learned through oral tradition. There wasn't much written about trail work at the time. But we went to the Sierras, and in the Sierras, they have all that gorgeous granite. They could build rock staircases up and down anything. They were not very good building a bridge. They were not very good designing a trail, because you always just build a staircase, so it didn't really matter. Come to the Northwest with all these great trees, and you could, you know, build a 70-foot bridge across anything, you know, with an axe and a few chisels. We went to the East Coast. We discovered there weren't any switchbacks, because as those trails developed, horses were not part of the mix. Mm-hmm. Western trails have switchbacks, because in the 1800s, distances were so great, you pretty much needed a pack string to get up into the mountains. So the Pacific Crest Trail has switchbacks. It's open to horses. Appalachian Trail, open to hikers, but no horses. And as we went around the country, we assimilated a whole lot of information, and the book Lightly on the Land is a distillation of what we hoped would be one good way to go about doing trails. If you do this, you'll get it right. But there are also all these other local variations and great stories and great traditions that make this whole trails world so fascinating and so interesting. So I think to answer your question about, you know, the local cultures and all that is, we very quickly became facilitators rather than instructors on our road trips. Mm. And we became listeners rather than preaching, you know, the word of the SCA from Yellowstone. And by being open to what was locally done, we could add to our own skill level and perhaps encourage them to pick up a few of the things we brought along. But mostly we got to learn and to see what all was out there.
Wow. Yeah, that's really great. So I think we're about at our time for the evening, although I feel like I'm talking to three legends in the global trail community, and I could probably keep asking you all questions for the whole night if I had the time. But in closing, one question I want to ask everybody is there a trail that is on your bucket list that you would like to hike? Or what is a trail that you you hope to hike in your lifetime as a bucket list item?
Go ahead.
Well, I was actually going to start and just say the GBT, well, as soon as I learned about it 10 years ago, has been on my list. And I hope to get out there, you know, at least to hike part of it. And also the TCT as well. Learning about that trail, I also held that one in high regard. So I was very excited to talk to both Ashat and Arianda today about those places. But sorry, go ahead, Robert. I cut you off.
Oh, I was also going to add the Trans-Caucasian Trail. I'd like to hike more of that. I haven't yet finished the Arctic Circle Trail. I've just done 20 miles of the 100 miles. So that's very high on my list to go back and finish that.
I'm very kind of, I don't have the bucket list of trails. I think any trail is a good one. Right now we are working on, like, with Bob on trying to figure out trails in Mongolia. And I'm just curious, maybe that would be a trail that I would like to be part of putting together, but obviously I will be one of the first ones to walk it too.
Yeah, it sounds like a fascinating design. I would love to hear more about the techniques you're thinking of for that trail.
I also didn't like focus on most, like, you know, I have a bucket of course of places which have trails. Of course, the first I would like to have the Transcaucasian Trail when it's finished to hike it all. I'm really interested to have an opportunity to hike in Dolomites and also in the Appalachian Trail in U.S. So a lot of things are coming to like sometimes, but some places which I will plan on, I want to do in the future.
I wanted to add one more thing that, the trails and the trail work we do, it's kind of a Zen effort that we do all of this work to build a tread, to make everything just right, working with tools, camping out for weeks. And we want it then to disappear from the view of the users. We want them to experience what's all around them. We don't want them to be noticing the tread under their feet. If they do, it's because it's too rocky or too steep or, you know, something like that that we might have attended to. But we want them to have experience. Mm-hmm. And that's really what we're talking about with trails, is that it's a doorway to experience. And whether it's just someone out for a walk for an afternoon or going, you know, the length of the Transcaucasus Trail, or if they're working on trails and having the opportunity to do that, trails offer experience and offer opportunity. And that's really what we're all about. And I think it's good to keep that in mind as we go through all the hard work of making this happen.
And we hope that when they have this great experience, they will fall in love so much that they will ask a question, how can I help? How can I help to protect this land around me? So that's the hope, that's growing one environmentalist at a time by trails, because trail is an excuse.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, thank you so much for being a part of our Global Learning Summit. This has been a really lovely conversation. I hope that I can keep in contact with all three of you. As I said, I have a million more questions in my head. Again, thank you very much for being here, and happy trails.
Great. Thank you, Whitney.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for inviting us. Yeah, thank you.